Hello friends, let us today study another novel and emerging technology in food processing and preservation, that is microwave heating. Before coming to the microwave heating, let us understand what is it, and particularly let us little bit discuss about the dielectric heating. Actually, what happens when an insulating material is subjected to an alternating electric field? As you can see here in the figure, there is some dielectric material is kept here, it is held, and alternating electric field through some AC source is supplied to this material. So, when this electric field is applied, then the atoms in the material get stressed, and because of the interatomic friction, heat is produced. And this heating process is known as dielectric heating. This interatomic friction is caused by repeated deformation and rotation of the atomic structure, which also is referred to as polarization. So, this technology, that is dielectric heating, generates heat energy within the product and throughout the mass simultaneously due to the frictional interactions of polar dielectric molecules rotating in response to an externally applied AC current. So, you can say that it is an advanced form of heating, much better form of heating in comparison to the conventional heat processes which are normally used for the food processing. Under the international agreement, only certain frequencies are allowed for the industrial, scientific and medical use, and this is just to avoid communication with the federal or interference with the federal telecommunication system, because the same sort of radiations, etcetera, are also used in telecommunication. So, normally for this radio frequency operations, that is in the dielectric heating may be of two forms, that is radio frequency heating or microwave heating. So, for radio frequency heating, 13.56 and 27.12 megahertz frequencies are normally used, or you can say in general that is 1 to 200 within this megahertz range. Whereas, microwave, it may be within the range of 300 megahertz to 300 gigahertz. In generally that is the microwave systems which are used in food processing, they have frequency in the range of 2450. And a bandwidth within the range of 896 to 915 megahertz. Let us see the microwave heating. Microwave heating is generated by the absorption of microwave by a dielectric material, and this absorption of heat by the this absorption of microwave by the dielectric material results in the microwaves giving up their energy to the material with a concomitant rise in temperature. And you can see here in this picture that in the conventional heating, heat source is somewhere else, and then this heat is transferred either through conduction or convection, whatever the system, depending upon the type of the material and heating source and other heat transport medium, it is transferred. right? But in the case of microwave heating, heat is generated internally, and obviously the time required to come to the target process temperature here in this microwave heating process is attained in a very short time. And in fact, some researchers, they have worked on these aspects, and they conclude that it is time, it takes about 1/4 of the time which is required for conventional heating processes. Microwave food processing, as I told you, it uses two frequencies, that is 2450 and 915 megahertz. Normally, 2450 megahertz frequency is used for home ovens, whereas for industrial ovens, both 2450 and 915 are used. So, the microwave heating processes, like any other process, this is also influenced by certain factors, that is factors of the material, factor of the environment, and other factors. So, here the important factor influencing this process, that is microwave heating, include the dielectric properties of the material, thermophysical properties of the food, and frequency of the microwave used. Among the dielectric properties, dielectric constant and the loss factors, or the loss factor, are the important causative agents are which influence the microwave heating process. Ability of the material to absorb and dissipate microwave energy obviously depends upon the product composition, the temperature, and microwave properties. The penetration of microwaves, which is taken as generally, it is the penetration is the measure of the ability of the microwave to heat, and this is determined by dielectric constant and loss factor of the food. Microwave absorption decreases exponentially with depth. Shorter the frequency, higher is the penetration. You can take the example of ice, that at 915 megahertz, the microwave can penetrate 30 centimeter deep, whereas at 2450 megahertz, it can penetrate only 10 centimeter deep. Also, the penetration depth depends on the state of the matter. Same, we take example of ice and water. And if we take microwave of 2450 megahertz, it can penetrate 10 centimeter in ice, but only 1 centimeter in water. So, these are the factors, that is the depth, frequency, and even the penetration depth, that is state of the matter. These are the factors which influence penetration depth or penetration of the microwave into the food material, and accordingly that the amount of heat, etcetera, is they can generate. The penetration depth can be measured by, that is x in meter, can be measured by lambda 0 divided by 2 pi under root, that is the dielectric constant, and loss tangent, that is the depth, lambda 0 is the wavelength, epsilon is the dielectric constant, and the loss tangent. By this equation, one can calculate, if you know the dielectric constant of the material, if you know the loss tangent, all right, you know the wavelength of the microwave, you can easily calculate what is the depth up to which it can penetrate. Similarly, the power generated in the food or power absorbed by the food can be calculated using this equation, that is P is equal to a constant 55.61 plus 10 to the power minus 14, that frequency and electrical field strength, and that is the power of the second power of the electrical field strength multiplied by loss factor. Okay. That is P is the power of power per unit volume, F is the frequency, and E is the electrical field strength in this equation. So, by these equations, one can calculate the penetration depth of the microwave as well as power generated into the oven or power absorbed by the food material. Let us, that loss factor is an important characteristic. So, let us see that what loss factor means actually. That is, loss factor is the measure of the loss of energy in a dielectric material. This loss may be due to conduction, slow polarization, and other dissipative phenomena. Either of these processes or any other processes, there might be the loss of energy. So, the loss factor is the total loss of energy. Okay. Most of the food have moisture content and therefore, they have high loss factor, and thus that is high loss factor means that they can readily absorb microwave and radio frequency energy, and flashover is not a problem. As you have seen earlier, loss factor of ice is less than that of the water. Water has more loss factor, which you can also see in this figure. It has been shown here by some researcher that variation in dielectric loss factor of water and ice. Okay. So, it shows that the water has more loss factor than ice. So, water can heat easily, and more heat, it can be heated more than that of the ice. Glass, paper and some polymeric films have a low loss factor. That, what does it mean? That they have low loss factor means they are not heated. And metals reflect microwave and they are not heated, making the microwave oven very efficient in energy use. How these microwave heating actually take place? Let us see the mechanism of heating. There may be two processes, that is, either it may involve heating through dipole rotation or through ionic polarization. As you can see in this figure, both, that is, that dipole interactions or ionic interaction is shown. That in the dipole rotation, there is flip flop rotation of dipole molecules like water, particularly that is water that has H positive, H positive and O is negative. So, these molecules are dipole molecules like water, there is a rotation, repeated changes in the polarity of the field causes rapid reorientation of the water molecule, and this rapid reorientation of the molecule results in friction and generation of heat, is mainly because of the friction of these molecules. Okay. Back and forth vibration of ionic salts like sodium chloride, you can see sodium ion plus positive chloride ions, and these ions move at an accelerated pace due to their internal charge, and collision between these ions can cause generation of internal energy. Okay. So, these are the ways by which actually main thing is that molecular collision, right? That is, the oppositely charged ion, when they are put in the microwave field, they try to realign towards the oppositely charged of the microwaves, and then in that there is a molecular movement and then actually friction, and this friction causes the generation of the heat. Microwave systems, that is equipment in the microwave, there are two main units or components. That is, one is the magnetron, that is the source to generate the microwave, and other is the microwave cavity, the where the food is or other material which we want to heat is loaded. You can see here in this is a schematic representation of the microwave system, where this the cavity when the material is loaded, oven cavity, and then this setup for the transformer, etcetera, it is with the electrical power plug, and then it energy is given to magnetron, and which normally produces the microwave energy, and then this energy is passed inside the oven. This is for the commercial or small scale or batch oven, microwave oven, but in the industrial ovens, industrial microwave systems are larger capacity microwave systems, wave guide becomes an important or essential component, because in that the magnetron is situated outside the oven. So, the microwaves are generated in the magnetron separately, and then with the help of the wave guide, these are transported to the microwave cavity. So, this magnetron and wave guide becomes two important component for consideration for proper, that is, heating system or proper design or manufacture of the microwave heating systems. So, let us see slowly that is with these two, that is what does a magnetron consist of. In this schematic figure, it is shown that is a microwave oven showing the positioning of the magnetron. Here is the magnetron, you can see that is this the magnetron, and other that is in the system. Now, when the microwave energy is generated, then these are the wave guide, all right, how, and this is actually the cavity. So, this is just schematic. So, the magnetron actually consists of a vacuum tube with a central electron emitting cathode of highly negative potential surrounded by a structured anode. Okay. I will repeat it again. That is, magnetron consists of a vacuum tube with a central electron emitting cathode of highly negative potential surrounded by a structured anode, and the power of the magnetron can range from 300 to 3000 watt depending upon the capacity of the microwave heating system or capacity of the equipment. The waveguide, as I told you earlier, it channels the microwave into the cavity that holds the sample for heating. There are several modes of waveguide in applicator: single mode and multi mode. Single mode ovens distribute the microwave into the reactor in a precise way. In a single mode system, the heating pattern could be confirmed and thermal processing could be designed and controlled, whereas in a multi mode system, the electrical distribution is random and it is hard to determine the heating patterns. Domestic ovens are generally designed with reflecting cavity walls that produce several modes of microwaves, and thereby they maximize the efficiency of the heating process. Now, the like any other process, the microwave process also can be a batch process, it can be a continuous process, all right. That is, in a batch process, obviously, the food sample is placed in the oven for a predetermined time to achieve a target temperature, and the power level is normally adjusted to achieve a certain desired temperature difference in given time frame. And this is that just again a schematic of the batch process and the system. It is the conventional microwave oven, but it is modified to suit the drying process. You can see here there is one air inlet and then balance system to conduct the drying studies, and also there is air outlet. So, actually it is the here the microwave capacity, that is where the microwave that is the food sample is kept. In the continuous process, you can see in this diagram that is the raw fluid or sample is pumped, maybe peristaltic pump are used, and this material is pumped through Teflon or glass helical coils, which are placed inside the microwave oven or cavity. Okay. And it may be one cavity or maybe several microwave ovens connected in series for the desired heat frequency or for desired heating process. Okay. And the fluid, after being exposed to the desired amount of microwave, is allowed to pass through a holding section and allowed to be kept there or held for a predefined or predetermined holding time. This is then followed by chilling in some form of a tubular heat exchanger or such other device. For measurement purposes, thermocouples are normally used for gathering sample temperature at the entry and exit points, whereas fiber optic probes are used to monitor the temperature inside the cavity or oven. Now, after having studied in brief that process about the microwave, how the microwave heat is generated, what are the principles of microwave heating, what are the different microwave ovens, let us see its application aspect. So, in the particularly in the food processing, obviously, this microwave process has lot of advantages. Okay. It is a type of volumetric heating, so the heat is uniform, it is instantaneous, not much heat transfer. Another problem which is associated with the conventional heating processes are here. In this case, it results generally in the reduced processing time, it is instantaneous process and control becomes very easy, even cleaning etcetera becomes easy, selective energy absorption by the polar molecules, and this facilitates its use in the drying applications. It can be combined with other energy sources and chemicals etcetera to improve the efficiency of those processes. Of course, like any other process, the microwave processing also, it is advantageous, but it also has certain drawbacks, because if you compare with other sources, particularly with the RF heating etcetera, the microwave generally they lack the desired penetration length, or they have less penetration power, and therefore, particularly its application for the large samples may become problematic. Also, because of the internal heating, the development of flavor etcetera, which are associated with the Maillard reactions and other things, they lack here. That is, those which are like a delicate brown color of the development of the brown color of the material, crispiness, all right, all these processes, actually not because of the internal heating involved, no heat transfers, all right, no surface heating. So these general which are requirement of some food processes, so they like here. So these heating process cannot be used, or it limits its use in those products. Okay. And of course, the measurement problems, that is the actually there are, although there are methods and optics or cables, etcetera, by which the temperature can be made, but anyway, sometime it becomes difficult to insert that probe, etcetera, into the cavity oven and without any loss of the microwave energy. So, it becomes problem. Other important aspect here, the problem drawback of the microwave processing is that dielectric loss factor increases with the increase in the temperature of the material due to ionic conductance, and this results in the hot areas receiving more energy than the cold areas. And this phenomena, which is known as thermal runaway, results in significant non-uniform heating. So, that is the one major drawback of the regarding food processing application of the microwaves. It can be used for tempering purposes, for pasteurization, for sterilization, for blanching, for dehydration, for cooking, or even for other food processes, for like for example, baking. They can be used in coagulation, improving the functionalities, etcetera. They can be used for coating, gelatinization, puffing, roasting. So, for wide ranging of process applications, for accordingly for preparation of different products, etcetera, or for improve the characteristics of the product to increase their shelf life, these microwaves can be used. Okay. So, whatever the process where heat is used, that these microwaves can also be used, but with different objectives. So, that is the microwave can be used for pasteurization purposes or for sterilization purposes. Here in this figure you can see it is a continuous flow pasteurizer, where there is the for the juice, or it can be used for any liquid material. There are two microwave oven, so it can be batch system one, or it can be several connected together, and the microwave is coming, the material is going, and it is exposed into one section to the desired microwave, all right, which are the probes or fiber optics, and then it passed through the second unit, and after that it is finally, once it is sent to the holding tube and followed by chilling. Okay. So, in fact, there is the it is a sterilization or pasteurization, it is performed in faster process, that is the rate of the process is because that is energy efficiency is more here. So, it can be conducted the very fast, and the come up time is normally less here in this. So, required temperature can be obtained instantaneously. It has advantages to overcome the limitations imposed by slow thermal diffusion processes of the conventional heating processes. Microwaves can easily penetrate the whole frozen product, thus effectively reach the inner regions within a short time. Microwave tempering can be performed in few minutes for a large amount of frozen product, like even 24 to 40 kg weighing frozen products, they can be tempered just within 5 to 10 minutes. In this system, you can see that these are again taken from the literature. These figure microwave pasteurization in container solid foods pasteurization system for the microwave, where the filling the product, then film and valve applications for the product is done, finally cooking and pasteurization, this is the conveyor belt in the material is made, and then it is passed through that microwave system, where it is exposed to desired microwave power label, and then finally it is given the, as you have seen in the earlier case, it is given the hold required hold time, and then finally cooling. And similar thing is that this is the microwave sterilization system, These figures are taken from the literature, just to give show you an idea of the equipment. Okay. Similarly, microwave assisted vacuum drying of the food. This is another very, very interesting and good application of the microwave, that is called MVD, that is microwave drying. And you can see the material that is before in this figure, see the material before drying, how does it look, and after drying, there is no much difference in the color. Another characteristic, that was shrinkage, but however the water is removed, the size has reduced, but there is not much difference on the texture and other things. Okay. So, it microwave assisted vacuum drying results significantly rapid drying rates, right, and the vacuum, it enables the product to be dried at a lower product temperature. So, the combination of microwave and vacuum, it becomes a very good and novel means of drying, and particularly the drying of those materials which have heat sensitive components, where there is the like bioactives or health ingredients which are which have the danger of getting evaporated in the conventional processes, they can be retained to a better extent in this microwave assisted vacuum drying. And here, of course, as external heat transfer by convection is absent in the vacuum. So, by using microwave, drying time is reduced significantly. It results in significant decrease in the operational cost. And many researchers have successfully used this technology, that is microwave assisted vacuum drying, successfully for dehydration of grapes, cranberries, bananas, tomato, carrot, garlic, kiwi fruit, apple, pear, etcetera. That is mostly the fruits which contain, which are, that is heat sensitive component, or which because of their low glass transition temperature in conventional thermal process, their drying and dehydration becomes difficult. So, for drying of such products, this becomes a very good process. So, well, friends, now in this lecture, we have so far discussed or studied about the microwave technology, which is a novel technology, or you can say an advanced heat processing technology, which generally eliminates the problems which are there in the conventional heating processes, and it is a improved means of thermal technology of the heating system for the food, where you can reduce the efficiency of the heating, you can reduce the process time, you can get better energy savings and economics, better economics in the products. And at the same time, the quality of the product can be maintained. You can get good quality in the processed product. Thank you.